What's up, you guys? Teak, Mighty Ness. I was stuck in Twitch land. Like, what? I was playing some speedrun I was watching this weekend and stuff. What's up, you guys? Welcome to day 374 making Songbringer. Today I'm making a local co-op. This is going to be awesome. You're going to play as Jib finally. Whoops. What's this? What the heck happened? Skip menu didn't work. What? What's up, Pedro? What's up, Sal Dongs? Yeah, Teak, you gotta play the game finally. You have a poison container. Do you really want me to tell you what it's for? Or do you want to find out on your own? Why didn't that work? What? Oh, killed my settings. My bindings. Oh, because I have a new controller in. Okay. Unplug the controller so the game doesn't think it needs to bind that one. Okay, so when I got my other controller out here today. I got this controller I'm going to dedicate for Jib. This is going to be Jib's controller. So I can test Jib out. While I'm playing, doing my normal debugging, I can play the game with the keyboard. And then if I want to play as Jib, ba-boom. He's always that controller. Yeah. Yeah, you do need to combine it. That's what you would do with it. Have you got the teleport cube yet? Okay, so I'm going to be adding some options to the new menu. Oh, this is pretty cool. Dang, you guys might not have seen this yet, but there's achievements now. So the next update coming out maybe like this Tuesday or Wednesday, so either tomorrow or the next day. There'll be some update with all these achievements. Look at this. Vanquisher, Abe Lincoln, the Bomberman, Journeyer, Completionist, Titan, Minimalist, Permanent Being, Speedrunner, Swordless Master, and the Odd Job Run. All these are different challenges you can get. You can play a Songbringer with. But anyways, there's 10 more that are all hidden right now, but that's only because I haven't implemented them yet. But there's some other really rad ones. And also, there's the leaderboard. So you got 80%. There's only one person on the leaderboard so far. And I didn't even beat the game. So this will be cool to have you all putting your like times in. And it shows world seeds too. So if this were you guys, if there's more people on the leaderboard, once that starts filling up, it'll show the world seeds. And I'm thinking that when you actually click on, like if I were to click on that world seed right there, it would take me to a list of it would take me to a sub leaderboard where it showed all of that world seed. So that might be the way I solve that, where you can actually kind of sort by world seed. So that's all exciting. What's up, Zilton? So I have to beat that room. I failed 5 times so far. Yes, the Odd Job Run. Yes, there's definitely the Odd Job Run. That's the tight. That's the top hat. Complete the game with only the top hat. You're drawing Wizard Punk? Hey, what's up, Thief? Okay, so I'm going to add some stuff to the input menu here where you can set controls and enable player 2. So the first thing I want up here is enable player 2 or whatever, or player 2 on off control. And then I'll also add set player 2 controls and reset player 2 controls so that you can set some custom bindings to whatever the heck you want to play as Jib. And that would be like you could do a keyboard. You could have a separate controller dedicated for Jib. And if you plugged into, say, two controllers that the game already knows, like an Xbox controller or a PlayStation controller, it'll just automatically recognize that. And then you can just play as Jib automatically. There's no need to go set your controls or whatever. But you would have to come in here to this menu and enable player two at least. So that's kind of how this will work. Player two can jump in on any Songbringer game and play as Jib at any point, as long as player one goes into the settings and goes to input and enables player one. There you go. That's all you need to do. So that's how this is gonna work, and I'm excited to do this, and I don't think it'll even take that long. All right, so I need another setting right here, or another choice on this menu, which is gonna be player to enable. So let's get a string. So we'll call this menu player two, and we'll just say player two. I think there's an on off. Is there on off already? I don't know. Version. Let's look for off. Less common. All right, there's no off. We need off and on. Where's yes and no? There we go. Let's put that right by yes and no. Menu on, menu off. It's gonna be for player two. And then the player two thing is just player two, and it'll just say on off with some brackets around it and stuff. Okay, so we want this menu player two. And this thing has an option callback, which is similar to how, I guess the closest thing would be the graphics, the way it changes the graphics, your window size. Rocket Bunny, nice man. Wow, you're already realizing why object-oriented programming isn't good? That's amazing, buddy. That took me years to finally realize. But remember, it's not that object-oriented programming isn't good. It's just that it has its pros and its cons. You know, as a programmer, you're going to use object-oriented programming every day of your life, probably. In some form, in some part of your system. Some part of your systems, it just makes more sense for your code to be object-oriented. Other parts of your systems, it can make a lot more sense to not have an object-oriented system, but once again, it's pros and cons. It's really annoying. Why is it annoying? Tell me why. Tell me why. This is your test. This is your quiz right now. I'm quizzing you on C++. Why is object-oriented programming annoying to you? Okay, so we're gonna have. And on create. We don't need to apply any kind of notice. But we're also gonna have a cycle. Let's comment out this existing code, all of it for a moment. And whoops. Right, this is kind of how this will work. As soon as this is created, it will take the current setting for the player to enable. So we need a setting basically. So in game, no, I don't even need to go in there. Yeah, let me just go to the saves and I can kind of imagine how this will work. The Quizmaster. Well, because to make a class, you have to do this. And why is that annoying to you? Oh. Well, did you know that you do not have to have a constructor and you do not have to have a destructor? Have you learned about initializing your, check this out. Tile scene. Did you know that you can initialize your variables now like this inside a class? So check this out. This is a struct, right? I'm using a struct here because a struct, you do not have to type in public. Everything is public. And if you design, there's, if you really want to, you can still make your struct parts of it private. But the thing is, by defining something as a struct, you don't have to write a whole bunch of get and set functions. And as long as you trust yourself, and why wouldn't you? Then is and as long as you design your struct in a nice simple way, it's okay to have everything public like this, man. That's what structs are for. So structs are really easy. And check this out. And because you can initialize your variable in your struct right here, like this, you don't have to write constructors anymore, really. As long as all this stuff kind of can be initialized here, you don't have to write a constructor. You don't have to write a destructor, really, if you write your class right. There's lots of ways you can get around not even really having to destruct your class either. And still, the class can function, or struct, class or struct, can function incredibly well. So keep learning, man. What's up, clock? Ahoy! Yes, structs by default are public. Everything in a struct is public. That's why you don't see me typing in public before all this, because you don't need to. Nope. The definition of a struct is just is basically from a C++ perspective. A struct is just a class that has all of its members public by default. That's all a struct is. But actually, if you think about it from the C perspective, all classes are simply just structs with private methods and stuff. Yeah, Rocket Bunny, yeah, you don't need classes. You do not need classes to still write good C++ code. In fact, the older I get as a programmer, I realize the beauty of C. You know what I mean? If you kind of like think about your C++ and try and simplify it a bit and try not to use C++'s you can get really wordy with C++. You know what I mean? Your a line of code can be so long and so wordy and all this crappy code from like 1990 going on, you know? Like you don't need that stuff anymore. C++ 11 is a lot better than all the other C++'s before it. Now we have C++ 14, which is a little bit better. And soon we're gonna have C++ 17. But anyways, I'm still waiting for Jonathan Blow's language. I can't wait for Jai. Anyways. Come on, guys, you can make your whole game in main. Yeah, Coco demands it. Wizard Funk, no way, dude. Was too lazy to draw it all. Yeah, I can't wait for Jai, man. I wish it was out already. I wish it was out right before I started Songbringer. 'Cause shit, I'm not gonna go rewrite 60,000 lines of code. But next game. Okay, so when you choose this option to enable player two, first thing it's got to do is look up the setting value already. Let's get that. This is get string setting. We're gonna look for player two. No, this is gonna it's gonna be a bool setting. Get bool setting. Enable player two. It's a nice simple name. I like it. Enable player two. Think we can live with this. Attempt number 20 million. Will I stream after Songbringer is over? It really all depends. I don't know. Probably. I can tell you that. Probably. I can't see myself stopping streaming at any point soon. So I love streaming, actually. It's cool to interact and share and laugh and talk and chat and stuff. And get things done for the video game. Can the main function be in a struct? I don't think so. But yo, no, yes, you could actually work it out. So totally, you could do a struct like you could do it like this, Rocket Bunny. You could go struct, right? It has some data, it has some other stuff, and it has a void main inside it, all right? And here's where you write all your main code. Int some code, blah, 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 equals one. And then you just go in your void main, you know, blah, blah, blah. You would go struct. Oh, you need a name for your struct. Struct S. It's a good name for a struct. So you would just go S to initial, you know, to create one. And then you just go S.main inside your main. That's all you got to do, man. There, you got a main inside a main. All right. You get what's going on here? Yeah, you got it. All right, cool. Right. Which main is the main though? Oh man. Oh, we don't need to track original val for this. It's a lot simpler than that. All right, so we're gonna change. Oh yeah, this is a menu player 2. This is our base string. Shit, we don't even need to set the text at first. Screw that. Or maybe we do. Does it need to be like a space at least? I don't know. Let me check that. And interface create. Just want to check if it still creates it if there is no text. Oh yeah, cool, that works. Better yet, just store a function pointer to main inside S and then call it from within main recursively for no good reason. Don't do what Salad Dogs is saying. He's joking. Nice, you help your sister. She wanted to make a text adventure? Cool. Oh, no way. Really? Oh, congrats. That's so awesome. Dude, what a way to propose. Oh my god, that's so amazing. That certainly would win my heart over right in like 2 seconds. I'd be like, you had me at Zork. You had me at Zork. What subliminal messaging are you including in Songbringer? I'm not telling. Mm-mm. Nope. Oh, this is just on or off. Okay, all right. So we got our val. And if we got... It's menu on or menu off. All right. Oh, and we need this cool bracket on the end. There we go. All right, cool. So now we have a create method, which should set our choice to either on or off, depending on this val, which is the bool setting. You're likely to be proposed to by a crew. You got a second monitor? Sweet. I'm jealous. Oh, that's like boyfriend, girlfriend. Yeah. Okay, so the next thing this little code needs is on left, right. So this is when the player presses left or right to change the setting. So it's going to be pretty similar to this. It just cycles through the setting instead of. Yeah, so we're just going to cycle the setting. So we get the vowel. We set it to what it's not. And we set it again. Whoops, this is supposed to be vowel equals not. Enable player to vowel, flush the save game, and then call our method set bool setting. Boom! That's all we should need to enable player to. Blah, 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 blah. Betrothed, that works. But that's when you're married, right? Isn't betrothed fiance? Is it okay to make a video of Songbringer? Of course it is. Yes, it is. It's explicitly stated. If you need any kind of explicit permission or whatever, it's wizardfru.com/press. Or you can just go to songbringer.com and click on the press kit. Ba-blam! Songbringer.com, press kit. And then there's this explicitness right down here at the bottom where you got monetization permission, so you can make your own videos of Songbringer. No problem. And even get paid to do it and not have to pay me a cent. See what I'm saying? You can go put your videos on YouTube and monetize the shit out of them if you want. I'm all about it. I encourage it. I decided to rewrite my platformer all in one CPP file with structs. Right on. I like it, Rocket Bunny. That definitely gets around the annoyingness, right, of having to go create a different file for everything. Creating classes with all that stupid boilerplate code you gotta write. Constructors, destructors, getters, setters. Fuck all that shit, man. You don't need any of that stuff. You don't need to use that and still use C++ effectively. And still use object-orientedness effectively. Because essentially, the second you give a struct, actually, this is technical. This is technically how it works. If you have a struct, let's say once again we have struct s. All right. And then we have an integer I inside struct s. All right. Okay. Check this out. How can I illustrate this? I want to show you what turns a structure into an actual object versus being plain old data. So this is okay, Rocket Bunny, this is really important. You need to understand the difference between plain old data and objects. All right? Plain old data is just plain old data. Plain old data is like an integer or a character or even a string of characters. Here's like blah blah blah. This is my string of 1,239 characters right there. All this is plain old data. Floats is a plain old data. Check it out. Even this structure we just wrote up here, struct S, S is also plain old data. How can I illustrate this again? I just ran into this problem myself a second ago. Okay, I'm trying to make it so the compiler complains that this structure is no longer plain old data. How would I do that? I wish I could just tell you. Anyways, you're just gonna have to trust me on this. The second you go and write a constructor for a structure, it is no longer plain old data. Oh, wait. Oh, wait. Can we make an array of these? Yeah, let's say we have a variable array. A variable array. I think this is how we do it. Right? Okay. There. I've got an array. But it's already not liking it. Oh, wait. I think we make this const. Hold on. We almost got this thing illustrated. This is a very important point. Okay. All right. We're ready. Okay, the second we go and we add a constructor to this now, we should get an error. Oh, damn it, it works. That's not how I was thinking. There's some other way I could show you this where this would create an error where you create it. But anyways, but trust me when I say that the second you add a constructor or even any kind of method, let's say I wanted to add an operator equals. Operator equals, you know, const RHS, blah, blah. That is going to also be, anytime you add any method, if let's say I even added, I wanted to add a method, blah, blah, blah. This is my other method, you know. That makes this no longer plain old data. But what this is really beautiful about structs is as long as you don't add any methods, that structure is still plain old data. It's still sort of a C thing. But the second you add the method, it becomes an object, and it becomes more C++-y. So what I'm trying to say here is there's ways to use the object-orientedness of C++ in very powerful ways without having to incur all its bullshit. Nice. Yeah, SFML is great. There's also... GLFW, it's not really, it's kind of, I guess they're kind of similar in ways. Yeah, was it instantiating a new of it? That's probably what it was, the hatchet, yeah. Or a variable size array or something like that. I forget what gives you that error. All right, so let's see if this works with the Naval Player 2. Oh. You guys can already hear the sound, so I'm going to turn off the sound. So it doesn't sound like it's echoey sound for you guys. All right, so player two is currently off. Is that kind of out? Yeah, I want a colon there. Colon, attention to detail here. See how anal I am? Player two needs a colon. There we go. Now that colon really helped. Player two off. Player two on. Player two off. Player two on. Yes. Oh, this is awesome. Okay, so if it's off, what if I press the F? Yeah, okay, cool. So I'm pressing the advance button that turns it on or toggles it. The left and right buttons also toggle it. Nice, right on. So I'm going to leave it on. I'm going to quit the game right now. And it should have flushed my save game, so I've got a setting, which is, man, there's a lot of these. Enable player one, player two. Here we go, cool. We got player two enabled. I might want to change this so player two is always disabled by start at the very beginning of the game. So you consciously have to go enable player two every time. No. Yeah, once you enable it once, if you still got the controller in and the player's there, then blam. Yeah, we'll just leave this enabled. Okay, so you never have to go back and set that twice. That would be bullshit. Bullshit to make people have to go set it twice all the time. Anyways, okay, great. We got player two technically enabled. Now we need player two settings and stuff for their, bindings. Right. Yeah, it's a little lower level. Right. SFML is more of an engine. GLFW is more of like just a library for Windows and basic GL stuff. Wait, so you can add a constructor. It's not plain data, but if you add a method, it also changes to not plain data. Right. Any kind of method makes it an object. If it doesn't have any methods, it's plain old data. But oh, you also have to keep your data uninitialized for it to be plain old data. So if you add struct s and you had integer a, that's plain old data. But the second I go and initialize it, that's technically like creating a constructor. Think of this like the compiler just went and created a constructor for you and initialized a to zero inside your constructor, because that's technically what's, I think that's actually what's going on inside the compiler. All right, so that makes it no longer plain old data. All right, so but you think about it pretty simple in the way that is, if there's any kind of method at all, it's an object. Without the method or the initialization, plain old data. Oh, sad dogs, nice. You got a different way of looking at it. Plain old data usually means that the struct class in question doesn't have any methods. It doesn't, and which means it doesn't modify its own data. Right. Yeah. Hence the name plain old data. Right. Yeah, to hatch it, that's a cool way to put it too. Plain old data just holds stuff and objects do things. Yeah. Zilton, first code. Nice, you wrote it in that one programming language you like, man. What does that mean, additional graves? Okay, so now we need controls for player two. Ah. Steam's popping up while I'm trying to stream. What? What? Okay, add bindings for player two. Reset bindings for player two. I think I added these strings already. Let's find out. Add bindings to, reset bindings to. Need that one. Okay. Now we should have all our strings ready, all of our menu options in place. And we just need to make it so, oh, we need controller two and controller two reset. So let's get those compiling and stuff, because this is going to take a second. Oh, we already got it. Controller two reset. Nice. Okay, I'm going to close Steam. Come on, go away. Distractions. I'm trying to stream. For what it's worth, my class equals new my class. Basically the same thing as my class, m equals malloc size of, and then mm. Right, yeah, salad dongs. I hope you understand that, Rocket Bunny, what salad dongs just said there. It's technically what new does, right? Prefer to treat zero as initialization when possible. Oh, see, that's really nice. Yeah. So Saladongs, does that, if you go my struct, okay, if you do that, struct s, SS, concepts. Does that initialize all this to zero? Or do you have to actually put explicitly zero? Because I always put zero right here. But was that actually wrong? Here. That's so cool. What if we throw some characters in here? Let's find out. Setting a breakpoint here. Let's see if Clang does it. So I'm going to keep it like that and see if that initializes them all to zero. Small font size 3 while programming in BASIC. It does. It does? Really? Wow, I never knew this. Oh, I don't know what menu I was just in there. Oh, input. So here's my structure. Yeah, you're right. Look at that. It put it all to zero. And if I don't initialize it, that should have random data, right? Theoretically. Yes, negative one is true. Anything other than zero is true. All right, okay, I didn't know that. I did not know that you could initialize a structure to zero by just doing empty braces. That's very elegant. I love it, Saladongs. Thank you for that. You taught me something awesome today. Tits, that's super rad. So if anybody's paying attention, just the difference between what we're talking about here is this. And this, okay, so if I do this, that gives me random data. This integer I, these 18 characters, they're just random memory because you haven't initialized anything. But what I was always taught to do or whatever, or thought I should do, is that if you initialize it to zero like that, that means that you initialize every member to zero. But this does the same thing if you just put it like that. It just puts everything to zero for you. Very nice, which is what you pretty much want for every one of your classes ever and structures. If you just started at zero, that would be pretty nice. But no, you gotta be explicit about that because you might want all that random memory. Which is why C++ is the way it is. So yeah. No, that right there, that would not get made on the heap where I had it just in this method. That would be a stack. But if I nuked it, it would be heap. Wait, so this is your first real code? You've done this before to me, man. I remember a stream or two ago, you said you coded, and it wasn't really your code. Now you're trying to send me an executable? Trying to troll me, huh, Hans Hilton? Trying to troll me with some crazy troll thing? Ternary computers? Ternary computer is a computer that uses ternary logic, 3 values. Really? It's actually... Wow. Interesting. I didn't know. I never even knew about ternary computers. Doc, what's up, Doc? No way, it's Doc. Doc and Boogie. What's up, you guys? Hey, guys. Pedro's finishing your presentation for your thesis. Nice, man. Nice. Oh, wait. These are supposed to be controller 2. Whoops. So what I'm working on today, guys, is Jib. You finally get to play as Jib. Oh, it's about time, right? Player 2. So this is going to be controller 2. This is going to be controller 2 reset. I'm doing good, man. I'm doing great. I'm doing what I love. I love this game. I love the way this game is turning out. How about yourself, man? How is everything? The code you said was made in 2013, so that does mean that you didn't write it. Oh, I just never wrote these. Okay, let's hook up these methods. Controller 2 and Controller 2 reset. So we can play as Controller 2. Play as Jib, finally. Oh, these are really short methods, too. That's great. Controller 2. Controller 2 reset. And now we need to hook it up. So this controller interface. Oh, wait. We already know. Player 2. Boom. Oh, this might actually work. You are affamed. How do you say that again? You wrote it, really? You wrote it in 2013? You want to play as Jib and let Rock tag along? Actually, I think there will... I'm thinking there might actually be a whole dungeon where you play as Jib. So, but maybe. We'll see about that. All good here. Slowly emerging from 6-month black hole project. Nice, man. Welcome back to the world. Welcome back. You've been at your black hole for so long, but now you're back in real time space. Real space time. What's up, PMC? You wrote it when you knew how to code, but then you forgot, so you're trying to learn again. Oh, okay. I got it. Okay, I understand now. I totally understand. Okay, so we got player 2 on. Now we're going to set some player 2 controls. So I'm going to plug in my controller. Does that work? Let's find out. So player 2. Oh, yeah. What? It's working, but no, it got stuck down on that again. It might just be this controller is sticky. Okay, it's binding every button. I only want to do button A and B for player 2. But let's see how this goes. Okay, just dump me out to the main scene again. That was a little abrupt, but let's see what happens. So if I go to the saves now and look at the bindings, oh, it didn't save any of that. Okay, we gotta figure out why it didn't save. Why did you save that? Am I gonna run it? No, I don't have Windows, man. You sent me an EXE. It's sitting there in your inbox taunting you. All right, man. Don't worry. You got time. You got some time. You got at least 2 months. At least 2 months for sure. Really? Well, it doesn't say Nintendo on it or anything, but huh. I never thought about them actually. It's not their. I mean, I drew that myself, but anyways, I can see how that might be something they would. I don't know. Yeah, definitely something I gotta look into now, just to make sure I'm in the clear on that. Okay, let's figure out what happened here in this controller interface. It should have initialized itself with player two. Let's just step into all this code. Yeah, they can. I always knew Nintendo was pretty finicky about stuff. I'll see, when I start with the controller, it wants me to bind. But I don't want to bind yet. Turn off this auto bind code or whatever. That's in game. So game. Oh, here it is. It checks its bindings before it skips the menu. Besides, this is more of a debug thing anyways. Okay, so I'm turning that off so that I can basically start the game with this unbound controller, and it won't force me to go all the way back to the menu. Chains of Gravity resemble the old school Gravis gamepad? Is it cool? Oh, the Gravis? I remember that one. Yeah, let's see it again. Okay, well, first I gotta step into the code. Alright, so I want to step it into this just to see. Doesn't it? It should set its player. Binding.player equals player. Cool. Alright, so it's gonna go create all these the graphics for this screen. And then this is what I want to see. I want to see it tick. And where it, I really just want to see where it sets the binding actually. Yeah, let's turn off that. And where it's at next binding. Oh, it's up here. Cool. So I want to see where, right up there, where it's saving the binding. Last time it wasn't working, so I'm trying to figure out why. What happened here? Maybe it just doesn't know how to save bindings for player two. I never even thought about that. Binding not player? No, that should be fine. Okay, let's let this run. You used to have a Fool's Duty. You used to have a Gravis gamepad too? I had a friend that had a Gravis gamepad. I was never lucky enough to have a gamepad, except for my Nintendo. You could just wait like 70 more years. Totally. Dude, that totally is a rip-off of Sony. Really? They used to have a patent on the D-pad and they don't have it anymore. Interesting. Okay, this is where it's setting its first binding. Okay. So, this should it should there. Set this I got the breakpoint here. And let's check out the binding. Yeah, binding up player two. Boom! It's exactly what we wanted to see. Ah, wait, no work. Step in. Wait, binding's not valid? Oh, because I don't think I've set up player two yet. Oh, all right, so that's pretty obvious now. So I haven't set the number of players in the game to two yet. Duh! All right, let's set that and recompile everything. Now there are two possible players in the freaking game. This could break everything. This could break the whole game. But it shouldn't. Where did I define kNum players? I'm gonna look at the other places in the code where I got num players. Just make sure all this stuff looks like it could be fine to have two players. For example, bindings, that's perfect. This is exactly what we want. Second, we have two players, we can have two kinds of bindings. That's great. Same thing here with the binding is valid. That's a Microsoft controller? That's the most bizarre controller I've ever seen. You kind of love it? Yeah, I should definitely check into it. Yeah, I know, a lot of debugging live, right? What's the 60-second highlights that you missed recently? Let me get into dig into the change log. Let's do the 60-second highlights of what's been new in Songbringer. Okay, so this week there's achievements, which I'm really excited about right now. Leaderboards, I'm super excited. Settings are now available from the main menu or from inside the game. That's kind of what that's th those are the main. And then also there's going to be play as Jib, so local co-op. This is all going to be version 0.85. I've been doing a release about every 10 days or every 7 days or so. The release before that, I fixed a lot of bugs. Before that, I got Jib pathfinding. That was pretty cool. The top hat and the blink. The blink now has this ability, so you I don't even know if you've played with the blink yet. Whoa. The blink is a sweet ass weapon slash movement tool. At first you the first it has three levels now. The blink has three levels. There's level one, level two, level three. Level one, you can't blink over things at all, but you can blink to the side, you know, or blink forward or whatever. You can go a certain distance and you can move a little faster. And you do a little damage. You do this AoE damage the second your blink lands. It's pretty rad. Actually, do I have. Can I show you that? Oh, yeah, there's dialogue. There's a whole story for the intro. There's cutscenes. I still got a lot of work left to do with the cutscenes, but I like V for my blinky. The blink's awesome because you can when you see when you hit stuff, you do this AoE damage, so you can actually beat the whole game just with the blink or just with the top hat. You don't even need the sword anymore. But the sword's pretty cool. Still, it's a great weapon. And the ghost sword's even cooler now, lately. I don't even got my sound on.
Thank you.
That was level 9. That was a level 9 boss there, so he's really tough. There's a lot of new stuff. Rocket Bunny Strux have increased my efficiency by 10,000%. That's amazing. That's crazy. Achievements are why I want to make games. Cool. You just earn achievements. Awesome. Yeah, you're going to play as Jib. That's what I'm working on right now today. Yeah, the Blink was in the game a long, long time ago, but the Blink was always just a way to teleport over stuff, right? And now it's that way when you power it up all the way. But at first, it's more of like a dodge, really. It's like a dodge, but it's also a weapon. So it's kind of interesting how you can use it as a weapon or a dodge. Armor Games, I love Armor Games' achievements. They do a great job of drawing their achievements. It's not, it won't show me those links because it says I don't have Flash on my iPad. Which I don't. What's this? Comparison of constant 2 with expression of type const player type. Oh. Okay, one more thing. There should be player 2 in constants. Oh, we already got player 2. Player 1, player 2. What's wrong with that then? Comparison of constant 2 with expression of type const player type. Oh. Here we go. Rip Flash. All right. Okay, I need to finish checking out if there's anything else that might have gotten changed by this Kingdom players. My player EADS. Okay, so I should now be able to get the player EAD for this guy now. Get my player EAD. That'll even work now. So we can have a player EAD for player 2. In fact, we should do that. Okay, so let's make Jib. When you create Jib, actually, let's look for set my player EAD. Is it create? Yeah, this is exactly what we want. Create heroes. All right, so when we create Jib, wait, set my player in. Oh, this is horrible. So get my player in. Set my. These need to be more hard. We need to harden these up. It's a procedurally generated game, no level editor? What is it, man? All right, so this should be a player type. Player type player, and it needs to be explicit, and then here this too, set my player EAD. Actually, get my player EAD. That one's gonna cause some problems if I don't make it this one default. So keep the default there, but set my player EAD should definitely not have a default. Oh, Linkfi, you're asking about Songbringer? Oh, I thought you were asking about Pedro's Link. Oh, so, I was so confused there for a minute. Oh, okay, I get it, I get it, I get it. Yes, Songbringer is a procedural game. There's no level editor. There's no data ever stored in memory. Just do that. Oh, I totally miss this attempted BC warrior train. All right, let's just be explicit. Everything is gonna be K player one. This is better anyways. Actually, let's just change all of these. Stop compiling. Replace all. All right, Rocket Bunny, 10 minutes of coding using struct. See what we got. What do we got? Struct window vars. Blam, dude, no constructor. Yes, and with initialized data. Awesome. SF render window win. Video mode. While win is open, while win pull event, switch event type, clear display, nice. Rocket Bunny, I got a suggestion for you. Your while loop, why don't you make that a function? Oh, link file, nice, nice. You're learning C++? That's cool. We've been talking about C++ on this stream a bit. Okay, so there should be a few errors left here in the code. It doesn't know what a player type is right here. Which is included from shaders. Actually, yeah, that's better. Okay, there should be some other. Wait, no, layer system. Kind of sucks to have to put constants into these. Oh yeah, no, I can't do it this way. Just make these ints. No, I can't make them ints. This is not right. Yeah, I'll make it. I'll move a few constants. That might break other stuff, though. Should I put in window vars? Depends on what you want window vars to eventually be. I probably would have. But I would probably think about renaming window vars to something more universal. Because at this point, if you're putting functions inside it, it's not really a window vars. It's more of like a window. Or more of like a game or something. Or like a game screen or a screen or something like that, you know? Just a suggestion, though. You could do it however the hell you want, man. It's your code. What? Some guy's in here after 5 minutes and he gets to be a mod? There's no one in here that's been here for only 5 minutes and been a mod. Every single person that's ever gotten to be a mod has been here a long time. Rocket Bunny, can you be a mod? Okay, we got two people asking to be a mod at once. I don't know if this is going to work right now. We might have to wait till later. Because if I give it to one person, I have to give it to both people. If I give it to both people, I have to give it to everyone. So that just ruins the whole point of being mods. So I'm gonna delay making a mod till another day. Okay, so that was a bad idea too. Damn it. All right, we'll just make... I'm just going to make these ints. This is really just sent my whole code for a loop-de-loop. Int player. Int player. And we'll just make sure and check it. Yes, Pedro, I am. Yes. I had my shader. The shaders are my secret sauce, man. Shaders are total secret sauce. So anyways, I have not, if you noticed, I haven't showed my shaders on any stream. Except for maybe this one. I might have accidentally showed them. Yeah, I gotta keep something back, man. I got 60,000 lines of code I've showed you guys, and like 10 I haven't. But anyways, yep, that's one of my secrets. It's one of my wizard secrets. Salad Dogs, can I please not be a mod? Teeks, can I be a mod? Why is the pragma necessary? The pragmas are never necessary. Pragmas are never, ever, ever a necessity. But the pragma once is a beautiful little pragma. Check this out. Look it up, man. Look up what pragma once means. You should look it up so you learn. But anyways, what I'm saying is the pragma once is a beautiful way of not putting include guards around your header file. Include guards are so old school. You basically have to, include guards are annoying as hell, man. You write these two long statements at the very beginning of your file, and you put another statement at the end of your file, which makes it so your file is never included twice, which is ridiculous. Or you can just do it with one simple little thing, one pragma, supported in every one of today's modern compilers. Pragma once, man. Use pragma once. Akuma, what's up? Coliseum duel to the death. No, Doc, no, don't take it that way, man. Yeah, you might not even, PMC, you might not even know who Doc is, but Doc's been here pretty much longer than anyone. The Wild West is calm. Yeah. Yeah, but once you got include guards in there, they're still ugly. Right? Am I wrong in saying that? Include guards are ugly. Okay, so I'm just finishing up some code to get it so we can have player two. And finally have player two. What? Player two. Set my player in. Title layer input. This is K player one. Area creation. This is K player one. K player two. Oh, wait. No, this isn't here. This is if, yeah. When we create the being there, set my player in player two. And there's gonna be one more. Here we go, set player id for player one. Player one and player two are now both zero. Did I say inclusivity is ugly? No, I said include guards. Include guards. Yeah, honestly, it's ugly that they're necessary at all. Definitely, definitely. You use, oh, PMC, you use the Steam key command. There's a Steam key command. You just brought, it's exclamation mark Steam key. Yeah, there you go. Now it's starting to look like something really beautiful to me. Rocket Bunny. Yes, Rocket Bunny. That's freaking awesome. Do you see? Rocket Bunny, do you see how your code is so much more elegant now? Very nice, man. This fills my heart with warmth right here. It's so awesome. Rocket Bunny, there's a really cool video from Linus Torvalds. I think it's Linus, but it's a TED Talk with Linus Torvalds, the creator of Linux. And he talks a little bit about taste in this video. You should check us out. Just type TED Linus. You don't even need this, just TED Linus, you'll find it. But anyway, this video, he talks a little bit about taste and programming in his talk here, and it's really beautiful. You should check this out. And it's very, very applicable to what the code you just wrote and this video are kind of connected in a way. I think you might learn something from it. Steam key, are you trying it? Oh, PMC. Oh, man, that sucks. Oh. So we had Teek saved up for like Teek saved up three separate times. He saved up like 1,000 points and tried his luck and lost three times in a row. So the fourth time he actually saved up 4,000 points and he got it. So 4,000 points pretty much guarantees that you win. So anyways, if you really do want to win it, save up some more points and you get a better percentage. Nice, Rocket Bunny. Okay, so let's see if we can now bind controls for player two. So I've still got my controller plugged in. I don't think I need to set that breakpoint anymore. I'm just gonna let it run. Here, I'll disable this one. Okay, so I'm gonna bind my controls for player two. Actually, I got an idea. Before I bind the control. Oh, and actually, wait, let's see if that worked. That was two little bind. Yes, it worked. Oh, nice. We've got some bindings started for player two. It's got everything right. So it's got the controller that I use. It's my gamepad, Nintendo-y controller. It's got axis two minus, which is the up and down. And number one is player two. And these are all not player zero. So boom, it worked. So I'm going to delete that anyways. And I want to make it so when you do that controller scene, or controller interface, when it goes to its next binding, it has a choice of what buttons and stuff it's going to do. So if we're binding player two, so it's if binding dot player equals k player two, and the button that we're binding dot button is greater than or equal to k button x. We're just gonna invalidate the string. So it truncates the whole process. Once it's got bindings up to button A and B, it's all done for player two. So in player two mode, how does the mechanic of jib finding items work? You press a button. So yeah, when you're playing as player two, the only controls you really have are your D-pad. And your A button, basically. Those are the two things. So you can move around, and then when you get over something, you press the A button, and he'll scan. That's really all it is. So you're like your six-year-old brother can play. Or your girlfriend that hates all video games can play, can still play and not be intimidated. My code where it resets the screen so it can draw to the window. Should I make that its own method? Yes, you should. Yes. Yes, Rocket Bunny. Yes, you've got the heart of it. The heart of it is to make everything you possibly can a small little method to a certain point, right? You make just about everything its own method. This could be its own method for me, you know, if I wanted. You know, this little bit could be its own method. This little bit could be its own method. To a certain extent, right? To a certain extent. But especially with the things that you're writing right now, your game engine stuff, a lot of that stuff is definitely going to be its own little method. No way, PFC won! Yeah! Nice, dude. Second try! That's awesome! So PMC, I don't know if you have do you have a Steam key already? But anyways, PMC, just send me an email. Here's my email address. Let me type it for you. It's nat@wizardfoo.com. Send me an email. I'll get back to you after the stream and send you your Steam code so you can play Songbringer right now if you want. Or I mean right after the stream. Because I can't get into my Steam keys right now. Because I would just give away all the Steam keys for free to everybody that saw them on this video that's going to be on YouTube forever and ever until the end of time. I would like to say thanks, Mom. And Zilton. DeHatchet, how long have I been working on this? This is about a year and a half. About a year and a half into making Songbringer. You can't? Salad Dungs. Yeah, Salad Dungs has a nice pragmatic look at it. I like that. You only break it out into another function when you're going to use it twice. Yes. So, Rocket Bunny, the thing that we're talking about here is called cohesion and computing. Cohesion and computing. Here it is. Cohesion and computer science. Let me post this on the link or on the chat here. Check out this link. I'll state what it's actually means in its heart, but Rocket ba. How do you spell your name? Is it B-U-N-E? Ah, there. But anyways, the overall concept of cohesion is simply that if you have a piece of code that you're using twice, let's say I had this piece of code right here, and then up here, I had this other piece of code. And, right? Look, I just wrote the same exact piece of code twice. If you're seeing a pattern forming, yep, you're seeing a pattern forming for sure. This is where this should be its own method. And typically this happens in another method where you've already got a bunch of code you've written or whatever, and then you've got some other code you've written, right, and stuff. And then you finally realize, oh my God, I wrote this code almost the same as that code, right? This could easily be its own method. That's what Saladong is talking about. He only puts things into a method when he needs to, which is very important that you do it when you need to, because if you don't do it when you need to, and if you kept all your code like this, you had exactly this code right here, and you had exactly that code right there, what you've done is you've created a code that's called coupled. You've coupled these two things together. It's the exact opposite of cohesion, so it's very not cohesive code. Basically, what that means is that you've repeated something. So the thing is, later on, you're gonna come back to this method, and you're gonna go, oh, you know, maybe that should have been plus equals one. And then you're gonna go, oh, wait. But there was that other time I wrote this code too. I should go back there and write that as plus equals one or whatever. You know, it's tiny little changes you make, but these things propagate because, oh my God, now you got this in two places at once. You have to go maintain twice as much code. This is totally horrible for you as a programmer. You're gonna waste all your time going and maintaining code. Everything's gonna get all spaghetti and it's gonna be crappy. So the point is, whenever you need code twice, you need to make it a function and make it reusable so you don't have to write code twice ever. That's a good way to put cohesion. Cohesion means you don't ever write the same code twice. It's a very important concept. Oh, you already have a Steam key. All right. Oh, well, you still won, PMC. So if you want to get another Steam key, feel free to give it to a friend or whatever. Sell it on eBay. It's all good. All right, PMC, we'll see you, man. Molly Rocket, huh? Working on The Witness. Oh, what? Oh, this guy worked on The Witness? Huh. This is a bit long for me to kind of read right now, but let me open it in my browser for later. Okay, so let's see if this works. I'm gonna try and bind just the controls for the D-pad and buttons A and B for player two. All right, so binding up, down, left, right, A, B. And it cut me out of there, but that's just because it finished. It shouldn't have cut me out though. It needs to put me back into the input menu. But anyways, now I should have bindings for for Jib. Let's check it out. So I'm quitting the game. I'm going back to my bindings, and yes, I've got it bound. So not only do I have player 2 enabled, but I have bindings. Now all I gotta do is write code. All I gotta do is write a little bit of code so we can control Jib right now. Oh! So in mood Jib, Jib's still gonna have an AI running, I've decided. I'm just gonna keep Jib's AI running completely. It's just that is when you play as player 2, or when player 2 is enabled, he doesn't automatically move and stuff. So let's check that out first. Bool or const bool is human. Game get bool setting enable player 2. All right, so now we just got to get him to move and stuff. Bafu's undead. He'll only come back stronger. Okay, I'm pretty sure this is really simple. If let's do this. Yeah, let's do this the really, really, really simple way at first. I'm just gonna go if is human, and I'm gonna return. So it's not gonna run any of his AI code at all if he's human. But I do want him to just move. I want to see if his movement can work by e.move.compister equals. Actually, we need to back up his old. e.move.lastCompister equals e.move.compister, and then we get his e.input.getCompassDirection. Is it really that simple? Is that all? Oh no, there's one more thing. In player controls. Oh yeah. Yeah, it's all in like input controllers and stuff. Nice. Circles and rectangles. Woo! Hey, what's up, Space My Name? While alive, die. That's some cool code right there. I like that. While alive, die. You just programmed all of humanity, man. You just programmed Game of Thrones. Boogie just summed up all of Game of Thrones in one line of code. He said it really elegantly too. I love it, dude. Boogie, that's a genius right here. Genius. Where is this, like, oh, I had my cursor on it the whole time. Set button down. Jeez, this is pretty easy. This is where we will handle player 2, as in, you mean... Oh, we don't even need that, do we? Okay, I'm going to set a breakpoint here. I just want to make sure that when I press a button for this controller, it's bound for player 2, that it gets this code here and runs that stuff. Nice. I just press left on my controller. Well, I do what I can. Credin, what's up, Credin? How can I play a demo of this gem? Thank you for saying that, Credin. You cannot play a demo, but you can play the beta version. There's a beta version. It's a private closed beta. If you want to play Songbringer right now, you can play it, but you have to pay $32 to me. Anyways, yeah, you can actually play it. You're basically pre-ordering the game if you want. You can pre-order the game for $32, and that gets you the beta version. So if you go to songbringer.com/pre-order, it's got all the details on here, but you can either pre-order the game for $16, which means you get it later this year when it comes out, or you can order this one, which is the you get the game right now, and you get a Steam key, and you can play the game, the current beta version, which is already on Steam and stuff. Or you can gamble here on this stream, Credin, too. You can save up points and gamble and see if you can win a key. Okay, so we got this. Let's see if we can get the right player, Yid. That was good. And my player, Yid's returning. Yid 3. Sweet. That's definitely going to be Jib. Cool. So now we're calling set button down. What button index? Up. Right, left. Looks good. Okay, let's disable that breakpoint. Okay, he's not moving yet. Damn it. Why aren't you moving, Jib? Come on, Jib, move. He's not even moving at all because basically he's human. So he's human controlled. Player 2 is doing a horrible job of playing right now. Come on, Jib. We gotta get you moving. Why didn't you that set button down? I guess I do need to enable this breakpoint and see it all the way. Does this work? Set button down. Entity get input component not blah blah blah. Oh, does Jib have an input component? You better. Jib, do you have an input component? No, he doesn't. This explains a lot. We need at least input. Allow all 8 compass directions. No, wait, this is flags. Flags, all 8 compass directions. There we go. Okay, so there, that should help. Should definitely help. Now Jib has an input component to be set. You can gamble. You save up points and then you can raffle them to get a chance to win the game. You get a point for every minute you watch or something like that. As long as you're following, you got to click the follow button. And then, okay, let's see if this works this time. Id 3 button should be all right. Input, bam, we'll get it. Input component, yes. Now we have an input component. This is great. Release times, active true, set button down, and step out of this method, disable the breakpoint, let it run. Yes! I'm controlling Jib! This is so great! Oh! He even made a little noise! Oh, and he can't go around there. Oh, I can't get around this. This is great. Yeah, Jib. Now we just gotta get him to scan. This is so great. Yes. I really can't wait to make his sound effects even more fun now. Like, can you go over this way? Let me out. Let me out. This is so great. This is a monumental moment right here. Holy crap. I'm so excited. Oh, that was the follow noise? Oh. I thought he was making noise. He needs to make noise, though. He needs to make a lot more noise. All right, so that's back in Mood Jib. We need to get him to scan now. Which is the part where I think I'll kind of want to leave his AI on, because maybe I won't. Maybe I'll just, maybe he should have a little method that I call. This is this debug path finding. See, he needs to recharge if he's dead, that's for sure. Scan. All right, so I am gonna do it this way. I'm gonna make it so this AI for Jib is always running. It's just that it doesn't do parts of the AI when it's player controlled. Okay, so I gotta go through pretty much through all of Jib's AI here. Man, there's a lot of this code. It's like Jib needs to be his own little class or something now. Huh, man. Will the player controlling Jib be able to do things Jib doesn't normally do? No. No. As you're playing player two's Jib and the real Jib, or the AI Jib, are just the same. They have the same exact abilities. There may eventually be something else the Jib can do with button B or whatever. So button A will be scan, and then maybe eventually he will have some kind of defensive item or something like a stun. Very simple web like a button B, which does something kind of to interact with the game. So that's all. But it will be equal. So both the AI and the human Jib will be have exactly the same abilities, exactly the same possibilities. Yeah, crit jet thrash, totally. That guy's awesome. That's Steven Hobblebrinks. Stefan? It might be Stefan. I don't know. I've never met him in person or heard his voice. But he seems like a really cool guy. I like his game. Death Thrash is rad. It's a cool concept. Okay, I think this is really is what we do. We can do if is human, we do human movement right here. Yeah, totally. Yeah, Death Trash looks awesome. Man, if you guys haven't seen some of the cool games that are coming out lately, of course you've probably seen Below. Below is looking sweet by Capybara. Okay, so you probably heard of Below. But what about, have you heard of Aider? Aider's freaking awesome. Sort of like Diablo-esque pixel art. Look at that. Look how great their art is, though. Their art is so good. Aider's looking so rad. What about Hyperlight Drifter was an instant classic. Children of Morta. Yeah, oh, they don't have any beta access for that, do they, huh? Oh, on IndieFarmer? Cool. Right on. Awesome. IndieFarmer? Do I know that guy? Most people have gotten in contact with me, and I send them free copies of the game, and they play it, and they write reviews and stuff. IndieFarmer. It's a YouTube channel? Anyways, if I don't know this person, I should get in touch with them and thank them. Don't Okay, so here's human movement. This is okay to leave this part if we're not human. Stats index, all these variables, these are okay. We don't want to set the last compass direction. If we're human, that's manual. So we do want to move the light though, based on his current position and all that. This is all where he starts doing his pathfinding, his perpendicular vectors, his movement towards his current target. Oh, you thought it was a game where you watch YouTube? Indie Former. Oh, yeah, this sounds familiar. Indie Former. I think this guy got in touch with me. I don't remember. And no.
Hey guys, my name's Lawrence.
And my name's.
I don't know. I don't remember this guy. Gotta get in touch with these guys and say thank you. That's cool. Okay, back to this code playing his jib. So we could still allow him to target different stuff. That's okay. Could even have him set a current target pause. But he never really needs to try a perp vector if he's not human. And we never really need to move. Actually, let's just let it do. We can let it do. Here, back all the way down here, after we set all these different perp vectors and try out the different vec and moving towards the position stuff. Just gonna invalidate his vec. We should. I don't want him to ever get a path, neither. Where is it that he gets his path? This part here, I think, is one that also shouldn't run if you're not human. Here. Let's do this a little smarter. After we've done all this EI, this vec manipulation here, if is human, this vector is always zero. And this human movement, I want to put this up before all this code back where it was, because this is pretty. It looks a little more organized. This is kind of a bad example of code right here. A lot of stuff is in one method. Okay, so where does he get his jib path again? Jib path. Oh, here it is. Yeah, so if not as human, we can pathfind. This is cool. Keep that enabled so he's always looking at the player. Debug his movement and stuff, show all his paths. That's fine to keep all that enabled. Here's where he follows his current path. He should never have a path. But this might be a good thing to actually block this too, if not as human. And we have a path. So we're always going to recharge a dead jib if he's close to the player. We might want to add some code here to make it so the player can, or that the player two can recharge jib just by pressing buttons. Do that. So if not as human and you're near, let's do this logic a little simpler. So So if not as human and that and that and that, or we are human and e.input. Is button down, K button A. So you got to press the A button to get back up if you're the player. You're playing as Jib. Okay, so this is where we move towards the target. This is only if we're not human. Scan. Okay, scanning. This is if we're not human. And if we are human, eat input dot is button down K button A. We have to be alive though. Okay, I think this might be all we need here. So he's gonna scan. Let's see what he does when he scans. You press the button to scan. He's gonna do his little animation. Let's make this instead of his button down. Let's see his button release. Did release button. We also want to do is and is not is scanning. Okay, so it schedules a callback to see for when he's done scanning, he does his callback and discovers his item or not, maybe not. And then this should reach it. Okay, we should have everything ready to go. Let's see if this works. So if this is all working, we should be able to control Jib and scan stuff successfully. All right, cool. I can move Jib. This is great. He gets stuck though. What's going on now? He's like really, really choppy movement. There's something happening with his vectors and stuff. Yes! Yes, you can scan stuff. He's always looking at the player too, so that's kind of weird that he, like, even if I want to move left, he keeps looking back at Rock. It's great. Scan the same mob 13,330. We need some real enemies to try. Wait, what? Oh, it paused because it thought the game was idle. Man, we need to do idle for both. Well. Yeah, Pedro, there already is an achievement for talking with all the NPCs. It's currently hidden, but that's only because I haven't finished implementing it. That will eventually be a totally visible achievement. I've got my eye on you. He did, permanently. He's like, I keep looking. I can't look away. We need to put the players somewhere where we can fight some enemies and stuff now. Like... Zero. 071 maybe? 7-2? No, 8-1. Sounds like a good area. He's pretty tough. Jib's a tough little cookie. Where's that little bit where he looks at the player all the time? Ah, here. Alright, so if not is human, look at the target. Scan one of each enemy type. There is already a kill every one of every enemy type. I wonder if I can like attract enemies. It would depend on the enemy type. This little red ball enemy type is super super dumb. There's no intelligence at all of these guys. Yes! Get back up, little buddy! Oh, the controls died though. What happened? He died and he can't get back up very well. You're not alive! Why are you not alive, Jib? What happened to your controls, buddy? Huh. Okay, let's get that fixed. Oh. What happens when he dies is that he has to get back up. Where's that recharge a dead Jib code? Recharge. Where the hell is that? Recharge. Recharge. There it is. Okay, let's see what happens if I die, but don't press any buttons. Hidden achievement, successfully unmod Wookie. You like the A blinking? Yeah, there's some good ones in here. It's cool too because you can see all the achievements from the game if I connect to Steam, which was being kind of annoying earlier with its pop-ups. Yeah, I'm excited to have the achievements in there. What language is the first Mario written in? That's a good question. I don't know. I would guess C. Yeah, so all the achievements you see right now are basically ones where you can beat the game. And then you get this like and then you get this thing if you beat the game a certain way or whatever. But there's 10 more achievements I have in here which don't these are none of those are going to be complete the game. It's like hit an enemy with two weapons. Actually, I'll show you. Let me show you all the other achievements that are left to do. Kitservices.h. So all these ones with the hat next to them are ones I haven't done yet. So there's going to be Psychedelic Wanderer. That's where you use a cactus and you find a secret. Boom, you get an achievement for that. There's Reverse Boss Order. That one's pretty rad. You have to beat the entire game in reverse. No, the stream's still here. No way, Mario was written in assembly. I didn't know that. You mix it up, Rocky Bunny. Really? Oh, I didn't know it. NES games were mostly assembly? Holy crap, that gives me so much more respect for the people that wrote Zelda. That's awesome. Yeah, so what else? There's zero damage. If you take zero damage throughout the game, there's Smiley Gland Hander. That's the one that Pedro was just talking about where you have to interact with every NPC. There's the Simu kill, Simu killer, which is basically you have to kill with two weapons at once. There's the Wonder kill, which means you have to kill 32 enemies within 1 second. That's going to be a cool one to implement. There's Omni kill, where you kill every kind of enemy at least once. Across runs, you know, so you could have different games, and you still can earn that achievement. There's survivalist, where you have to have less than one hit point after vanquishing a boss. So basically, if you beat a boss and you have one hit point or less, you get this achievement. But ultra survivalist means you have to beat every single boss in a whole run and have less than one hit point. So that's gonna be kind of an interesting one to try and get. There's Discoverer of Worlds. This one's cool because all you got to do to get it is you have to play a world seed that no one has ever played before. This is going to be a very interesting one to implement. This is pretty simple. There's 308 million worlds. Songbringer will likely never ever have 308 million players. So it's guaranteed that every player that ever plays Songbringer will actually be able to discover their own world. If you're a completionist and you want to get all, if you want to get it, it's totally doable. And there's also this one, the Ultra Completionist, where you have to unlock all these non-hidden achievements. There's only one hidden achievement so far. And then there's Titan as well. Titan means you complete the game with only 3 total hit points. So you never, ever pick up a Demon's Tooth. That's going to be a crazy hard one to get, I'm sure. You have to beat the last boss with only 3 hit points. This is going to be cool. Yeah, there already is one for completing the game without taking damage. It's already there. Invincible. Complete the game without taking damage. Yeah, I guess there could be another achievement where you complete every boss without taking damage. But these are a lot to implement already. I'm going to keep it kind of how it is, cuz we already got. These all work. These are all guaranteed to work. So in this version that's coming out like this Wednesday, you'll be able to get all these achievements. But these ones will not work for a minute. I got to implement these. So I've kept them all hidden so you guys technically can't see. But what I'm trying to say here is don't try and make any progress towards these achievements yet, because the game is not set up to track it. So basically, if you try and start doing these weird, crazy ones, reverse boss order or whatever, you're not going to get the achievement yet. Whoa, the source code for the SNES game, Bob? No way, that's cool. Wow, even SNES was assembly? Wow. Really cool articles. Okay, so back to Jib. We had him so he didn't recharge himself. Why was that? Oh, I'll just die again. And this time I'll set a breakpoint so we can see. God achievement, complete all achievements. There already is a complete all achievements achievement. Yep, that one's called Ultra Completionist. You have to complete all the other achievements. Okay, so I've got Jib to die. He's stuck now. I can't get him to move. Wow, let's figure out why. I think it might be that it's trapped up here in the top of its code. Right here. So, boom, we should hit that breakpoint immediately. And what's his animation? Oh, it's okay. So he gets past that bit. Oh yeah, of course, he's already up anyways. So what's his health at? Tell me this. Oh, yes. Yes, the entity worked. Okay, yeah, his health is 0. His max HP is 4. So what? Why doesn't he recharge? You have to beat each boss while being high on a cactus. Nice, I like that one too. I should put these in the ideas list for other more achievements. Okay. So you had the idea for beat each boss while high. What was the other one? Oh, yeah. Beat each boss taking no damage. Okay, there. Got some more ideas to the for the achievements. All right, so why Jib? Targets the player. Gets the target's position, resets its vector. Wait, does his move he's his movement locked? Maybe his movement's locked because he has a vector or velocity. No, his velocity is zero. Okay. There we go. Health is zero. It's not going to work right now because the button's not down. Okay, so I should let this code run. But I need to put some kind of breakpoint here and figure out why this isn't working. So I'm definitely pressing the A button and I'm not seeing anything happen. Okay. So if is human, I'll be equals is button down A, and then we set another breakpoint here. Whoops, the hell happened there? There. Okay, so now we got a breakpoint. This should be hit. Okay, but I want to hit it here. Actually, I want to go if B. Now, this might be broken right there, so we'll figure that out. Fill the largest diamond bag with diamonds. Achievement: beat the game without saving. Well, that's already kind of permadeath. The permadeath one is basically without saving. Fill the largest diamond bag with diamonds. That's actually might be cool though. Wait, beat the game without saving. You mean on regular mode, you beat the game without saving? I'll put that on the ideas list. Beat the game on regular mode without saving, but it auto saves. I don't know. Fill the largest diamond sack. Beat the game without playing the that's so great. I wish I could make that an achievement. So does that mean if you watch somebody do a playthrough or a speed run of Songbringer, does that count? You achieved beating the game without playing the game? Does that count? Is that how you get that achievement? You have to watch somebody play it? Listen to some commentary. All right, Jimmy. He's moving around. He's moving around. Oh no, I'm getting hurt. No, I'm dead. Okay, so I'm back up and it's not gonna have button down. Where is it? Let's find out if there's anything fundamentally wrong with this bit. No, it should be okay. All right, so now we do need to do it this way. We only break if B. A boris and bell want some parking. It's called the all-nighter, play 10 different seeds from start to end. Is that in a row? Hide a menu option called beat the game? Okay. Yeah, so here's the problem. I'm pressing the A button, but it's not triggering the is button down part here. This is never true. Why not? Let's see if the button even works. Input controllers. Set button down. If button index equals K button A and player index equals K player 2. Set a breakpoint here and figure out the very fundamental issue and whatever is going on here. Achievement, bury Jim in a hole in the desert and leave him there forever. God. Hey, play without Jim taking damage. That's a good one. That'd be a really hard one though. It'd be super hard, but it'd be easy to get this if you had a player playing as Jim. Yeah, so Jib takes no damage throughout the whole run. Beat the game by crashing the Songbringer into the final boss. Don't say that, man. Don't say that. No, that's actually... Oh. I've considered this that might be part of the plot actually. Have you seen what I posted on Trello? No? What are you talking about? Wait, was that? You posted some stuff on Trello? I haven't checked it much this week. Oh, you got it. Wait, wow, you got so many achievement ideas, dude. Pearly whites, complete the game without picking up teeth. Finish with the initial 3 health. Hey, that's kind of like one that's already on there. But I like the name Pearly Whites. But one of the things about all the achievement names is they're all titles. So they need to be like, that's the theme. The theme of all the achievements is, this is a title that you earned. So. No, that I don't want to say much more about it right now because it totally would be a huge spoiler. So. Yeah, just forget that I mentioned that and that you mentioned that joke. And yeah, we'll just all forget and just move on. That nothing ever... We didn't talk about anything right there. We were talking about achievements the whole time. Ready to rumble. Get the sword and top hat within X time of starting the game. Huh. Oh, that's kind of cool. Like, you're super fast at getting the top hat and the sword. Here, let me copy all your ideas into the ideas list. I'm sure these are all great. Treasure hunter, find a secret room. We do have the psychedelic one, so yeah, but that could definitely work too. That could be another secret, like you have to find a secret room. Finding a secret in the overworld is a little bit different than finding a secret in the dungeons. I think this could be two different achievements, yeah. Arts and crafts, craft every possible item combo. Yeah, that's a good one. That's a great one, man. Yeah, we're not going to mention anything. No. What? Mentioning? We don't mention things. Story dungeon progressing. Oh, right, like an achievement that like... You mean this is like, oh, this is actually pretty cool to do an achievement where you just track... You track the dungeons, so every dungeon that you beat is a progression achievement towards one achievement. So basically it's just getting you to win the game. Oh, you know what? All this would be is just taking any percent. The goal I already have for any percent, or the which is the one that's like any percent is technically called Vanquisher. So yeah, Vanquisher just means you complete the game with any percentage of items. This should be made to be progress tracked, and that would be really interesting. So you could see your progress towards beating the game once for the first time, you know? I could do that. Yeah, so each time it sets a little data point for the user that's like, this is the maximum level that you've beaten so far. Okay, let me just write that down here. This is progress tracked Vanquisher. All right, so that's just making that achievement a little bit cooler. There's this guy that will love your game, Lobos Jr. He would play your game for hours and hours. Do a speedrun after beating it the first time. Awesome, cool, Critten. I'm sure there's. I'm really excited to get the game all finished so that these people that are great speedrunners that I respect so much. My God, the speedruns of especially Super Metroid, man. I love speed. Saladong's showed me a great link to Super Metroid Reverse. It was so awesome. But yeah, I can't wait for speedrunners to get really in there and get their times up on the leaderboards and stuff. Have an accepted suggestion for achievement and putting it in the game. Crowd surfer, leap off the stage and crowd surf while a band is performing on Songbringer. That's pretty awesome. Weakest link, clear switch room using only the weakest item. That's kind of interesting. So you're... Yeah, in the switch room, you clear the whole thing with only a certain item, which is your weakest one. I like that, yeah. Yeah, these are cool. Homewrecker, destroy all breakable tiles in a dungeon. That's crazy, but it could definitely be something achievable. It'd be a lot of work on some of those pillars, though. Clean up, kill all enemies in a dungeon. Oh, that's pretty good. That's a really simple one that somebody that would get rewarded for on accident. They'd be like, oh, wow, cool, I got an achievement. Oh, this would be just whatever the weakest item in the whole game is. Okay. I think these are weapons, right? You have to... They technically have to be a weapon to kill things, so yeah. Finish without buying any items? Yes, the cheapskate. That's a great one. Never buy anything. I like it. Loyal customer, spend X amount of diamonds in the same shop. Yeah, they do. They generate their items again, except if they're no, they always do. Yeah, if you buy a bomb container in the store, it'll have bombs the next time you go there. But not like the jib light. So the jib light would be one where you could buy. Yeah, but anyways, you could still get this goal. I like it, man. I like it. These are some great ideas. And they're saved in this document here. So as soon as I get to making some more achievements, these will all be in consideration. All right, so where were we at with Jibby? Oh, we're gonna need to test this code here. There's some software that emulates getting achievements from any Steam game, but there are games that can protect against it. Uh-huh. How do they protect against it? Good question. called Nice link, man. This is a great link. Gib.me. I love this guy's URL. This guy's got the best URL ever. Steam Achievement Manager. You just get all your achievements. Oh, this might be how he does it. How games do it to protect against it. So there are ways that that only a game server can give you achievements. So I would have to write a game server, which is hard and a lot of work, and I probably will not be able to do that by the time I release Songbringer. So it looks like achievements may not be secure for Songbringer. So this is how they do it. This is how games protect themselves. If you write a game server, the way Steam is set up is that either the player can activate an achievement or a game server. It's not both. You know, there's no way. If you set a certain achievement to only be something that a game server can set, then the player can't do it. So this thing basically just emulates that the game that the player set the achievement. And then this would be that, you know, basically the way you would write it is your game talks to your own game server and says, hey, game server, I did this achievement. And then the game server is like, did you really do the achievement? Let me check. And then the game server says, okay, sure, you got that achievement. Or no, you didn't get that goddamn achievement. Why are you trying to ask me about this achievement you didn't get? Cheaters are going to be cheaters, man. I know, yeah, it's not going to be worth it for this particular project, but maybe I'll do it eventually if it becomes an issue. It's hard to get hit by these guys sometimes. Oh! Okay, I pressed the button, and it did work. Awesome. Have an id, set the button down. It's all good. Okay. It's got one of its buttons set, button up. Second, false. What? Is downs true? Button A. Why did button A not get in there? Am I going crazy? What? This is really weird. This data must be messed up because it says this button array is size 12 and it's only showing me one of them. Dating simulator command? It looks like it is setting the input. It might be just clearing the input by the time. There is something in here where it clears. It sets the biggest axis value. It's not an axis value. What could be going on? Why it sets the player the button down, but it doesn't get all the way to the Jibs AI. Something in the middle is like resetting his control or something. Huh. I don't know. The heart wants what it wants. Yes. I love that saying. Oh, I got it. So I'll set a breakpoint here as soon as I press this button. And then inside mood jib, I'll have a breakpoint ready. And then also in input system, I think it might clear the, oh, this might be it. It might be clearing his input here in the input tick. Hopefully it's this. Now get all my breakpoints visible and ready. Don't want this one. Want that one maybe. Want that one at first. Wait, no, I don't want. Yeah, we'll get that one. Okay, we're ready to do this. Toby Peters, what's up? Custard's last stand, you keep getting your butt whooped. The game is just simply too hard for you. You just suck. That's the achievement. 33 slides of pure magic? Right on, man. Oh no. Okay. So we got that breakpoint, and I want to set the other breakpoint in input system and also this breakpoint here in mood jib. Okay, so I'm letting this fly. Set button down. Should. Oh, did my Xcode crash or something? Damn you, Xcode! Oh, this is like the first time Xcode's crashed all year. Oh, wait, it's coming back. I don't know if it's going to be able to make it. Quit. You just quit. Damn you. Okay, I gotta turn that back off. Not that. This back off. Let's reset Xcode. Whoa, I've been streaming forever today. This is cool though, being able to play as Jib. It's gonna be great. If only I had like a little brother. Like, hey, little brother, play the jib. Yeah, so I am gonna wrap it up here on the stream. I'm gonna see if I can get this one little bug fixed for like the next 5 minutes, and then that'll be it. Okay, jib's dead. Press the button. Set the other breakpoints. Run it. Okay, the first thing we get is mood jib. That's interesting. So it doesn't even call input system. At this point, jib, do you have your button down? Should. Buttons is once again size 12, and we have no idea what's inside it. Okay, let's see if we can go to where he actually starts to try to move. Oh, he was hurt still. Okay. And this is false, right? Down false. Okay, now the button's not down anymore. Oh, so we gotta turn this off again. Okay, Jib, you're not dead. Press the button. Turn these back on. I'm sure this is all simple. Now the jib's dead, set this breakpoint. Not that breakpoint. Okay, so I need to press a button. Now set this breakpoint, that breakpoint. Let this run. Oh no. I already got down false. Hold the down button. Keep holding it. Press this, press that. Let this run. What? It's immediately setting down? Who called this? Use values. Second is zero. What? Oh, because button right? is not down. All right, there's obviously something very fundamental here going on. I don't know, I'm not quite understanding, but I think what just happened here is that as soon as Jib dies, I have to go, I don't know. I'm not sure what's going on, but I can't stream anymore. It's already almost, what, 2.5 hours. So yeah, this is all it for today. Proton Gaming, what's up, Proton Gaming? No, there's no release date for Songbringer yet. Why not just go indie? You do have to have a good game. It's true. You stream as long as you want. Yeah. But then it goes so far. Once I start getting hungry, I start talking less. Like, you can already tell I'm talking less because I'm hungry. I only made January, February, and half of March. Then the thesis happened. Oh, yeah. The thesis happened. That's right. Pager's been working hard on his thesis. So anyways, that's it for today's stream, guys. I'm really excited to have Jib moving around on the screen with the controller and controllable by player 2. So my goal for tonight is to refine this new code, figure out what's going on with this little bug here, where when Jib dies, he can't move anymore. That should be pretty simple, I'm sure, to figure out. And that's going to be... Gosh, I'm just so excited to have two players now. It's a two-player game now. It's mostly still a single-player game, but cheers, you guys. Have a good one. Thanks for watching.